George Rodriguez is automatically a special person to me because George is from the great state of Texas like I am, and we Texans stick together and we take up for each other, unless you had the misfortune of attending Texas A&M University, but that's another matter. George was a White House appointee who served in both the Ronald Reagan and George H.W. Bush administrations. He's been a guest contributor on Fox News and on Univision and hosted a local radio talk show. Today, George blogs and writes under the name of El Conservador from his home base in San Antonio, Texas, where he does his best to make sure that people know that there is more than one point of view on immigration, as well as many other issues within the Hispanic community, which is really an act of bravery and courage. And if it weren't really for George, a significant part of our Hispanic population really in that part of the country would not have an effective, articulate voice that George gives them. So it's really a great pleasure and honor. And George, thank you for leaving Texas, coming all the way to be with us today. Would you please come up here and share some of your thoughts with the board?
Let me begin by thanking Casey for the invitation to be here with you folks. I feel very, very humbled and honored to be here. I spoke to Ms. Swain earlier when she walked in. She and I had the opportunity to testify in the House Judiciary Committee back in 2011. And I think that she would agree, but the treatment that we got from the ranking minority member, who was John Conyer, the treatment that we got was just amazing. I mean, to me, it was the height of the lack of respect. I, at that point, was the president of the San Antonio Tea Party, and he began addressing me by speaking to me, calling me Mr. Tea Party. And, you know, I don't know how he would have responded if I would have said, please refer to me as Señor Tea Party. But it was, you know, it was amazing to watch the disrespect, you know, the other members of the Democratic Minority Committee there were equally bad. The gentleman from Puerto Rico, the representative from Puerto Rico, who was about 2 months later arrested for, or had to leave his position because of sexual harassment or something like that, was equally very, very disrespectful. I want to chat, though, about what I think is one of the greatest problems that we've got in America, and that is the Spanish language news media. Spanish language media, period, but Spanish language media news in particular. I was raised in San Antonio. We're fifth, sixth generation Texans. So I call myself an American of Mexican descent. My parents were very, very adamant that there was nothing Mexican about us except our culture, you know, and that fact that we lived so close to Mexico, and that was it. We spoke Spanish at home, but the minute that we got into the street, it was English. And that was all there was to it. I am the youngest of my family, a very large family, and my older brothers and sisters, my older siblings, I remember them complaining that they were that they would be fined a nickel or something for speaking Spanish in school. And I remember my parents being very, very quick to tell them, well, don't do that. It's disrespectful. What a thought. That whole idea has gone by the wayside in our society, and it's been complicated by the illegal immigration, the huge amount of illegal immigration that lasts 20 years, and the Spanish language news media. The Spanish language news media got its start, in my opinion, got its start on on dividing our nation in about 2006 with two things. First of all, in 2006, do you remember when they had the huge marches, the illegal aliens, the huge marches, May 1st, 2006, and they marched down the street waving their national flags, hundreds of thousands of them, amazing. And I remember, at that point, I was living in Charleston, West Virginia. I mean, that was a culture shock for me from South Texas. But I was living in Charleston, West Virginia. And by the way, I love West Virginia. They beat Texas Tech yesterday. Oh my gosh. Anyway, I remember, you know, the sentiment, the ambiguity that a lot of these folks had in West Virginia about how, well, you know, they are, you know, poor downtrodden immigrants. And, you know, to those of us from Texas, no, they're not poor downtrodden immigrants. Son mojados. They are, my parents used to call them wetbacks. Can I say that? Oh my gosh, write me down, you know, call Mr. D's. But I mean, that was the fact. These folks compete with Mexican Americans, with Americans of Mexican descent. They come into our communities and they compete for the jobs, they compete for the social services, they bring their problems, they bring their crime. You know, that's something that's never talked about in the Spanish language news. The Spanish language news, Univision, Telemundo, they're the worst ones. They were the ones that started talking about los inmigrantes, like if it's everybody's just an immigrant. There is no definition. There's no division between, you know, those that crossed illegally and those that are here illegally. No, they're all inmigrantes. And when I used to point that out to them and say, no, some are not emigrantes. They're here sin papeles, ilegales, whatever you want to call them, but they're not here as inmigrantes. And that began to bleed into the English language media to the point that now whenever I get I get a call from somebody from NBC, rarely, or CBS, these reporters have the nerve to tell me I cannot use the word illegal alien or the phrase illegal alien. They tell me that. Oh, no. Can we not use that phrase? Why? You know, they're aliens. They're here illegally. What's the problem? Oh, no. Undocumented immigrants. You know, it has affected. Then there, on top of that, there's the situation where the portrayal in the Spanish language media of these illegal aliens is that they are victims, that they are victimized. You know, we've had in recent months, as the Border Patrol has started doing its job finally under this administration in South Texas and in Arizona and other places, the smugglers have kicked up because now they just can't walk across as easily as they used to. Now they got to get smuggled in. And so now these people are being smuggled in. They're paying to get smuggled in. They're doing it voluntarily, okay? Nobody put a gun to their heads and said, come all the way from Guatemala, get in this truck, and we're going to smuggle you across. They're doing it on their own. They're paying thousands of dollars to do that. And the media turns around and portrays them as the victims. The Spanish language media, the regular media, portrays them as the victims. And then says that we somehow are responsible for their misery because we want to enforce immigration laws. My friends, my grandfather, who lived who was a young man in the early 20s, used to talk about the crime on the border. Well, if he would see it now, the crime has just gone beyond the border. It's in Nebraska, it's in Iowa, it's in Massachusetts. The headaches that we used to have in Laredo are now up here. And why? Well, because we feel sorry for them. My friends, the headache that we've got is that we do not have a response to the Spanish language media or to the media in general, because if Casey says something, he's a racist. Look at him. Okay? He's white. If I tell him something, se lo digo en español, what are they going to say? They short circuit. You know, one of the tragedies, Fox Latino, there is a Fox Latino, they quit calling me. They quit calling me about 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when I did an interview with them and I told them that Dreamers were here illegally, and I felt bad for them, but they're here illegally. And they deserve to be treated exactly like illegal aliens because they're here illegally. And because the minute that you start rewarding and excusing illegal immigration, you get what?
More.
Exactly. And because we cannot turn our nation into the world's, into the orphanage of the world, where everybody drops off their little kid here. We can't do that. And so they quit talking to me. Somehow I offended the producer and the reporter. Well, I got news for you. It's the fact. And these folks in the media, if they are going to be objective, and they're not. They are destroying our nation. They are creating an audience of victims because it's never their fault. I mean, the estimation of Univision and Telemundo is that they reach something like 92 million households. Now, that's not all illegal aliens, but that's a lot of households. So they are infecting, and I'll use that term, they are infecting a lot of households with their liberal attitudes, with their liberal mentality. In Spanish language, we do not have a Rush Limbaugh. We do not have a Hannity. I try to do my best, but I'm a podcaster, and then at the same time, I've got very few reporters that call me. I had NPR call me, and we did an interview, and NPR was somewhat nice, but then as soon as it was over, I asked, or should I say Texas Public Radio. As soon as the interview was over, I talked to the producer, and the producer says, "Yeah, it was a good interview, but I think that you're out of your mind." Now, if the producer thinks that, how can we get an objective point of view? On the other hand, you've got folks in the print media who, doesn't matter how I do it, I try to give them a statement. I tried to give a couple of months ago, during Black History Month, we had the Houston Chronicle ran an article about the new slaves and talked about illegal aliens. And I had to point out, I couldn't help it, but I go ahead and write it, for what it's worth. These folks, these illegal aliens didn't come chained to a boat. They didn't come chained to the boat. They didn't get picked up and dragged here against their will, And once here, they aren't forced to work for free. I mean, how can you compare the black slave experience with illegal aliens who are paying $2,000 to a coyote to come to be brought across? And then once they're here, they can get welfare. Just ask Jerry Brown. They can get free education. They can get a bunch of things. But the media will not explain that. The Spanish language media, in particular, will not. They celebrate illegal immigration because it behooves them to have more and more Spanish speakers, because the bigger their audience, the better they can market their commercials. It is not important to them to have a society that is has one language. It is not in their interest that they have a society that salutes one flag, that has one culture. It is not in their interest. And we have to figure out how we're going to challenge them. And the best way that I can think of it is that we've got to challenge them in the media themselves, or ourselves. We've got to create alternative media, a conservative Spanish language. And when I talk about Spanish language, I'm not talking about Spanish language that will encourage separatism and segregation. I'm talking about one that will talk to people about the values of being a citizen, about the values of entering this country legally, about the values of educating yourself, about the values of a free market. That's the other thing. Oh, so many times I talk to these Spanish language reporters, Telemundo and Univision, Radio Azteca, off the record, on the record, I talk to them about free markets. It is just, you know, well, how can a poor illegal alien compete? Well, first of all, he shouldn't be here as illegally. Let's start with that fact. Well, how can they compete in an open market? Well, you know, you can't. If you're here illegally, that's the starting point. But that's not, you know, legal, it's become so obvious, particularly by watching the Kavanaugh hearings, it's become so obvious that to liberals and Democrats, the idea of legal, anything legal, is not it's not important. I mean, you know, a lot of times you watch these folks walk around with a sign that says, no human being is illegal, you know? They are just, I'm not sure what they drink, you know, in that aspect of it. The thing that I want to emphasize, my friends, is that we have got to do something about Spanish language media. We've got to create it for our own message, with our own message, and we've got to challenge the other folks, Telemundo and Univision, because they, my friends, are segregating. They are dividing our nation, and not only that, they are undermining it with their leftist reporting. They are undermining it, I guarantee. Every time that they accuse a police officer or a Border Patrol agent or some Republican for trying to pass a legislation that's not in their interest, every time they do that, they are undermining the Constitution. They are undermining our nation. They are dividing us. And when they are reaching a population, and you know the recent report by Yale University and somebody else about how many actual illegal aliens there are in the United States. I mean, you know, I could have told you that, you know, there's maybe 30 million rather than, you know, the 5-10 million that they've been talking about. I think that the report itself is a low ball number. You know, we have got to tell Latin American nations who listen to Univision and Telemundo, we've got to tell them, coming here illegally it's wrong, and you should pay the consequences for it. It is wrong. Let me open it up and ask see if there's any questions. Yes, ma'am. She's asking about how to combat sanctuary cities, or how to support anti-sanctuary city legislation, whether or not it'd be a good idea to promote it on Spanish language radio. I think so. Now, you're going to get a lot of backlash immediately because they're not used to it. Immediately, you're going to hear from people say, well, you know, that's hateful. You're being hateful. But if you explain to people, if you explain in your reasoning that in a legal society, in a lawful society, we cannot pick you know, particularly the leaders of the community cannot pick and choose which laws they're going to enforce, and that illegal crime comes into the Hispanic community. That's where they base themselves, because that's where they can hide in the open. If you explain those things, I think that the reception will be very, very different than what the liberals would want. I will tell you that my blog attracts tons and tons of conservative Americans of Mexican descent, as I call them. Tons of us. Because we know the headaches of illegal immigration firsthand. You know, I'm tired of some, you know, I've been called a Nazi, okay? I don't know, do I look German? You know, and I hate to stereotype, you know? But for crying out loud, I have been called a Nazi, strictly because I proposed and supported the enforcement of immigration laws. I had a school teacher call me that, a Nazi, a school teacher, in front of his students. An Anglo school teacher, okay? Call me that. So, you know, these folks live in their own little world, and they have no idea of the response, and we don't have an idea of how good the response to a conservative message is. Let me tell you a real quick story, and then I'll answer your question back there. Wendy Davis, who ran for governor in Texas a few years back, about 4 years back. Wendy Davis was very, very proud that, you know, the Democrats were going to bring all of their strong Hispanic Democrats to the table, and they were going to sweep into the governorship. Well, let me tell you what she did. Again, the liberal mind, the white liberal mind, as Carol said. She paraded around with two gender different individuals and went into Hispanic communities, into Mexican American communities in South Texas, where you've got all of these macho old guys, most of them veterans. And these people would walk in, and I hate to say it like those and like that, but these folks accompanied her, and they would, let me tell you, in the Democratic primary, she lost 5 South Texas counties. And she was the favorite for the Democrats. She lost it because some guy in South Texas says, no, we can't, you know, that's not us, that's not us. And so, but this is their mentality. They don't understand it. And what happens is that no, we don't challenge them, and the Spanish language media, along with the rest of the liberal media, pushes the idea. So white liberals think, well, it must be true. Yes, sir. Question, who had a question? Yeah, go ahead, back there. When I worked for Secretary Kemp, well, Congressman Kemp, when he was Secretary of HUD, I was charged with directing the contracting for a bit within HUD. And HUD would let contracts to small minority-owned newspapers around the country to advertise the sale of its properties. And inevitably, in Los Angeles, in Phoenix, Denver, San Antonio, Houston, New York, Boston, all of these communities had Spanish language newspapers that literally lived, Spanish language newspapers that literally lived off of the contracts, you know, from HUD and anybody and any other federal agency that chose to advertise whatever. And these newspapers were inevitably attacking Republican policies. So here we were feeding and subsidizing the dog that was biting us. It was amazing. And when you called them out on it, of course, you know, you're being a racist because you're calling us out. What we need to do is, again, have the strength, have the courage, have the guts to say, no, we're not going to do this blindly. If an administration is going to give contracts, and that's what it is. I mean, they're not competing. They're getting contracts only because they're minorities. If they're going to get a contract, then they have to do something for us.
George, I have a question.
Yes, sir.
There was this thing incident where this Google employee came out with her emails that said that despite Google's efforts to kind of increase Hispanic turnout in the 2016 election and bias things in favor of Hillary Clinton, that it was a huge disappointment that according to exit polls, 29% of the Hispanic voters voted for President Trump. And my question is, since 2016, now we know about record low unemployment in the Hispanic community and in the black community and in the whole community of Americans as a group, do you think that Hispanic support for now is stronger or weaker for President Trump?
It is definitely stronger. I was on Fox News about 3 weeks ago talking about how there was a poll and there was a substantial bump after the president had again asserted that the wall was going to be built, a substantial bump in the popularity among Hispanic voters. And you know what? To my knowledge, Fox was the only one that talked about it. When I reached out with the story to Univision Telemundo, nada. Okay? Excuse me, nothing. Okay? I guess I need, I should have some But, they hate it. Liberals hate it when I make fun of them. I don't know why. But they can't stand that. They can't stand the facts that Hispanics, we have been told, And I don't use the word Hispanic all the time because there is no such thing as a Hispanic. Okay? There are people of Mexican descent. There are people who are Puerto Rican. There are people of Cuban descent. And we're all different. I had never met a Cuban until I came to Washington, D.C. in 1981. Never met a Puerto Rican. I'd never, I thought they all acted and looked like me, And then I saw a black Cuban speaking Spanish. Oh, my gosh. And I said, my goodness, what do I do now? Yes, ma'am. The question is... she would like to hear more about the diversity in the Hispanic community, and it is a curious thing to me how liberals love to lump us together and don't recognize the diversity while they propose to be all for diversity. It's convenient to lump us together for political reasons. But, when it comes to the actual diversity, I'm sorry, but I have more in common with KC than I do with a lot of Salvadorans. I'm sorry, I do. I mean, let me tell you, now that she brought up that I was a Mormon, I served my 2-year mission in Mexico City, in Mexico, not just in Mexico City, but in Mexico. I learned, my friends, after 1 month in Mexico, and I was there for 2 months, for 2 years, didn't come back. After my first month in Mexico, I realized how much of an American I was. Red, white, and blue, Yankee Doodle Dandy. That's what I was. And I used to cringe. I used to cringe when I'd hear somebody talk, I would hear some Mexican talk about, despairingly about the United States, about them having lost Texas and California, about how Yankee imperialists, had taken their land, and how awful it was that I was a traitor to the nation. My family's been in Texas in the United States for 6 generations. If I've been a traitor to anything, it's my nephew who goes to Texas A&M. That's the traitor. You know? It is, my friends, just because the last name is Rodriguez and just because I speak Spanish doesn't mean I have everything, anything in common with some Juan that just crossed the border. On the contrary, you know, my brother, I have two brothers who are Marines. Oh my gosh. Let me tell you, once a Marine, always a Marine. That's so true. If they ever see anyone not stand for the national anthem, oh my gosh, I've got to be careful with them because, you know, those Marines are crazy. Yes, yes, sir, back here, right there. When the question is about my feelings about the term people of color, again, I think that that is a political ploy. Just like, you know, when they use the term Hispanic, just when the Latino, people of color, that is a convenient term to divide, to segregate, and to push whites out. It's very, very interesting, for example, when you sit at our Thanksgiving table, the Rodriguez Thanksgiving table, you see the last names Robert, you see the last names Pfeiffer, you've seen the last names O'Connor. That's what you see at our table now. Okay? The thing that angers me with Telemundo and Univision is that they don't recognize that our experience, at least the Mexican experience as well as the Cuban experience, is just like the Italians, the Jews, and anybody else. We are mixing. Now, the big difference is that we didn't have to cross the Atlantic. The unfortunate situation is that there's more coming constantly, but they aren't coming from necessarily just Mexico. Now they're coming from Bangladesh, you know? Now they're coming from Central America. And those folks are being told that they don't have to integrate. That's the problem. They're being told that they can maintain their identity and language and culture and still be happy and free. Well, that doesn't help. The question of people of color is one that is negative in tone and in attitude. And when they talk about that, let me tell you, people of color are disappearing. If we had a strong immigration laws that were being enforced, if we had a strong, secure border, people would be integrating, people would be assimilating. It's happening anyway, but we have millions that are not getting that message, and unfortunately, that's the problem. Yes, ma'am, right here, yeah. And let me stop you there because the question is regarding the organization Libre. I do think that they do a very good job. However, I think that too often they apologize for illegal aliens, and I don't have time to apologize for illegal aliens. They believe in a very libertarian economy, fine and dandy, a very global libertarian economy. I believe in a very strong, secure border. And, you know, I believe in a very strong libertarian free market economy within the United States, but I don't want to compete. I don't want our workers to compete with unskilled, uneducated folks that just crossed the border. I'm sorry, I don't do that. So I support them, and I think that they have a good approach, but only to a certain degree. Yes, sir. I am a nationalist. I am an American first. Okay, I am an American first. I do not apologize for that. Now, I am not a nationalist and a socialist. Okay, I am not that. I am not a nationalist, you know, an ethnic nationalist. You know, I am an American first. Okay, and I do not apologize for that. Now, let me. Dovetail on that to a few of my friends who I call professional Hispanics. These are folks who make a living off of being Hispanic experts, off of being everything, you know, you know, they know what's happening in the Hispanic community and they speak for the Hispanic community. Well, you know, I do my best not to do that because I think that all Hispanics should speak for themselves, particularly, you know, through the vote. And secondly, I don't know what it really a Hispanic is anyway. So, you know, I am very much a nationalist. I am very, very much an America first. I red, white, and blue. The first time I ever went to Independence Hall, I got all, you know, choked up. The first time I went to the Jefferson home, I, you know, in Mount Vernon, I got all. When I walked across Gettysburg and Bull Run, I got all. I mean, this is my land. This is my home. Oh, let me make a shameless pitch. This is my first book, not very good, I will tell you, but it is a compendium of essays that I have been writing for the past 6 years. Just went on the market on Amazon, and you know, I would encourage you, please, you know, support an American of Mexican descent who's a nationalist.